Hey everyone! Today I want to talk about 8 very common power efficiency myths when it comes to home servers. Things I see very often in my comments section as well as in other places on the internet. A lot of them are things that are true when it comes to general purpose computing but just don't really apply when it comes to server builds. So if you're new to home labbing, you should definitely stick around for this one, because a lot of those things were pretty new to me as well. Now, before we dive into the power efficiency stuff, I want to bust one very pervasive myth. Math and computer science are boring and difficult. Because they don't have to be, thanks to the sponsor of today's video, Brilliant.org. Brilliant.org is an online learning platform for STEM subjects. If you didn't like math, physics, and informatics in school, Brilliant is the perfect place to rediscover your love for sciences. They feature tons of courses on math, physics, computational biology, and scientific thinking. And if you have a more professional interest in mind, Brilliant also offers courses on data analysis, computer science, LLMs, and programming. Not to go all life guru slash influencer on you, but if my 20s taught me anything, is that the best kind of investment is an investment into yourself. So, who knows? Maybe Brilliant.org could be the first step to your new career. If you want to try it out, go to Brilliant.org/Wolfgang and get your free 30-day trial. The first 200 people to sign up will also get 20% off their annual subscription. So thank you Brilliant for sponsoring this video, and now, let's dive into the power efficiency myths. Myth number 1. Idle power consumption only matters if your system is not doing anything useful. Ever since I started making videos about power-efficient home servers, I got asked the same question. What's the point of measuring the idle power consumption? Does your server just sit around looking pretty, doing nothing all day? And no, obviously. My home server is currently running about a dozen of Docker containers, serving files over SMB, downloading Linux ISOs, and doing a lot of other useful things. But even with all those things going on, the system still spends most of its time in a so-called idle state. If we look at load average for the past minutes, we see a load of 0.12, which means less than 1% of one thread. And according to PowerTop, the system spends 88% of the time in an idle state, in this case C6. Why is that? Well, imagine, if you will, a workstation or a gaming PC. Usually, when you turn on a desktop PC, it's because you want to do something on it, be that gaming, video editing, web browsing, coding, or something similar. I have a couch gaming PC connected to a power meter, and here's what it looks like when I'm gaming. It's not powered on very often, but when it's on, it goes full ham. And now, for comparison, here's what a graph from our home server looks like. See the difference? Now, of course, sometimes my home server has to do some more resource-heavy tasks. Here it is doing a snap rate scrub. Here it is transcoding 4K HDR video. But what's important here is the percentage of those resource-intensive tasks relative to the time that the computer spends powered on. My gaming PC only gets powered on when I want to play games. And every time you see it on the graph, it's going full blast and draws hundreds of watts. Whereas my home server is powered on 24/7, always ready to download and serve media, generate invoices, and scan documents. And as you can see, not all of these 24 hours are packed with high activity tasks. In fact, most of the time, your always-on server will probably just spend chilling, running background tasks, and waiting for your next command. So, in short, no. Idling doesn't mean that your server is doing absolutely nothing, running no services, and being useless. An idle, or lower load power efficiency, is a very important metric, especially if your build is running 24/7, a metric that is often overlooked by mainstream tech reviewers, who focus on TDP and full load power consumption. Which brings us to misconception number 2. The lower the TDP, the lower the power consumption. TDP, or thermal power design, basically refers to the power consumption of a CPU under maximum load. And these days, even that definition isn't really accurate. Most modern CPUs feature some kind of auto-overclocking tech, where the CPU can boost way beyond its base clock and base TDP, as long as the cooling and power delivery can handle it. AMD calls it Precision Boost Overdrive, Intel calls it Turbo Boost, but it's basically the same thing. Anyway, the TDP number only refers to the power draw under maximum load, and unless your CPU is practically hammered, it's going to downclock and consume way, way less power than its TDP. At idle, most modern CPUs consume less than 1 watt. Seriously, if you have Linux installed and you have an Intel chip, go install TurboStat and see for yourself. Most of the power draw on your idling system actually comes from your motherboard, chipset, onboard devices, and any of the PCIe and SATA devices that you might have connected. A system with an i3-9100T will use the same amount of power at idle as a system with an i9-9900K, even though these CPUs have vastly different TDP ratings. And even though TDP might be a useful metric for building a workstation or a gaming system, it's not very useful to estimate the power consumption in a home lab environment. Now, that being said, if you plan to buy a CPU with a high TDP, you should still pick a cooler that can handle the heat. Your server might be idling 98% of the time, but don't forget about the other 2%. Myth number 3. Undervolting the CPU will lower your idle power consumption. Now, this is another common myth. In case you're not familiar with undervolting, it's a practice of running your CPU or GPU at the same frequency, but lower voltage. Since no two chips are made equal, chip manufacturers usually err on the side of caution and make all chips of the same model run at the same voltage. But if you get lucky with the silicon in your particular chip, you might be able to run it at a lower voltage, thus giving you better thermals and lower power consumption. In a lot of cases, it can even improve your performance. If your CPU or GPU is thermally limited, undervolting the chip will make it run cooler, and thus give it more headroom to reach higher clock speeds. Now, unfortunately, even though undervolting can help quite a lot with power consumption at load, it doesn't do much when it comes to idle power consumption. As I already mentioned in the previous points, the CPU contributes very little to your overall system power consumption. I've tried running a 125mV undervolt in my home server, and I haven't really seen any meaningful decrease in the power consumption. You might be able to shave off like 250mW, but at this point it's not really worth it. Myth number 4. ECC is a must-have for a home's... Nah, we're not doing that one today. Myth number 4. ARM computers are more power efficient than x86 ones. Now, this statement, in and of itself, is true. The new ARM processors do usually deliver better performance per watt than the x86 processors. Apple certainly proved it with their M-series chips, and these days you see more and more ARM CPUs in the data centers as well. Amazon, for one, definitely thinks that ARM is more power efficient than the x86, even going as far as to claim that their Gravitron instances use 60% less energy compared to their x86 nodes. So the obvious question is, if I care so much about power efficiency, why do I never talk about ARM? Well, there are two reasons, and the first one actually has nothing to do with the power consumption. I have 8 SATA drives in my current home server, 3 hard drives and 5 SSDs. In addition to that, it also has a 10GB SFE Plus card connected to it. And as of now, there simply aren't any ARM SBCs that would either have 8 onboard SATA ports or feature enough PCIe connectivity for me to use both a simple PCIe SATA controller and a 10GB networking card. The ITX 3588J does get pretty close, but the price they're asking for the 32GB version, that would probably negate any potential power savings compared to a much cheaper and more performant x86 system. And the second reason is the fact that ARM's efficiency under load doesn't really translate to idle efficiency. I mean, sure, an M1 MacBook Air consumes 6 watts from the wall at idle, but so does this x86 desktop system, based on the Intel i7-9700K and a Fujitsu motherboard. And unlike the MacBook Air, it has an M.2 slot, 4 SATA ports, upgradable RAM, and 4 PCIe slots. And I mean, just look at the energy-efficient build spreadsheets from the Hardware Lux, which I'm going to link in the description, by the way. There are builds that would rival a Raspberry Pi, with one even consuming less than 1 watt at idle. Yes, the whole system. Now, does the Apple M1 have better performance per watt than the i7-9700K? You bet. Does the Raspberry Pi consume way less at full load than the i5-9500T? Absolutely. Does your typical ARM SBC provide a similar level of expandability and upgradability as an x86 system? Nope, not really. So, to sum it up, even though ARM is a more power-efficient architecture than the x86, this power efficiency doesn't translate into a meaningful decrease in the idle power consumption. Apart from that, most available ARM systems are pretty limited in terms of I/O, and the ones that aren't usually cost an arm and a leg. Mythos Nummer 5. Newer means more power efficient. Now, looking at how far computer hardware has come in the past decade, it's fair to assume that if you compare a modern CPU to an older model, it would probably outperform it at the same power draw. So this obviously means that newer computer parts are inherently more power efficient than older ones, right? And I feel like I'm repeating myself a lot in this video, but still. Just because a certain part has better performance per watt, doesn't necessarily mean that it consumes less at idle. Here's a good example. I've got this ASRock C236WSI, which is a Skylake Mini TX motherboard. And I've also got its spiritual successor, ASRock IMB X1231, which was sent to me by ASRock, and which I'm going to make a video about very soon. Both boards have the cheapest i3 CPUs of the respective generations in them, the i3-6100 for the Skylake board, and the i3-13100 for the older Lake board. And if we look at the idle power consumption, it's not even a contest. The older 6th gen board draws around 7 watts at idle, and the newer 12th gen motherboard draws more than 10 watts. Now, obviously, a 3 watt difference is not something we lose sleep over. And if we look at the difference in performance, the i3-13100 is obviously way, way faster than the 6100. But just on the face of it, newer hardware isn't always more power efficient and idle than older hardware. And as we've established earlier, it's the idle power consumption that really matters in a home service scenario, not raw performance per watt. So if you're deciding between, let's say, a Kaby Lake build, which you can get for 50 bucks, and an older Lake build that you'll have to buy new for like 300 bucks, and you want to get the older Lake one just because of the supposed power efficiency, like you don't care about the actual performance, in my opinion, just go for Kaby Lake. You'll be more than happy with it. Mythe numéro 6. Laptops and low-power embedded CPUs are more efficient than full-blown desktop machines. This one is tricky because at a first glance, it actually makes sense. Laptop CPU designs draw less power than desktop designs, which is obvious since laptops are made to be run on batteries and can't dissipate as much heat. So since laptop CPUs draw less power, why not just take a laptop CPU and put it on a desktop motherboard? That way you get the best of both worlds, the connectivity and expandability of a desktop, and the power efficiency of a laptop. In fact, there are quite a few motherboards from companies like Airing that do exactly that. And if we look at the mini PC markets, basically all of them come with CPUs originally designed for laptops. There's also a whole lineup of embedded desktop CPUs that weren't explicitly designed for laptop use, but are still built with low power and low heat applications in mind. Think Celeron J4125, Pentium N6005, and more recently, N100. With that out of the way, the question is, are these CPUs really more power efficient for home server scenarios than full-blown desktop CPUs? And the answer is, it depends. In my Ninkir N16 review, I compared the idle power draw of an older Lake laptop and a Kaby Lake desktop. Surprisingly, the desktop build actually consumed way less at idle, which shows us that laptops aren't inherently less power hungry than desktops, at least for home server use. Same applies for using a laptop CPU in a desktop motherboard. In one of my earlier videos, I've tested this Xeon E2176M CPU, which is basically a laptop chip soldered to an LGA 1151 adapter. And as I found out throughout my testing, this mutant CPU doesn't draw less than a traditional desktop chip, like the i3-6100. But what about the embedded desktop chips? For what it's worth, something like an N100 isn't inherently more power efficient at idle than, let's say, a Kaby Lake CPU. And to demonstrate that, I have yet another motherboard that I'm planning to make a video about, the ASRock N100DC ITX. At idle, it draws around 7 watts, which is pretty good, right? But the same is true for the 7-year-old ASRock C236WSI and the Intel i3-6100. And don't get me wrong, it is very impressive that N100 manages to beat the i3-6100 while consuming almost 10 times less at full load. Not to mention that it has a way newer iGPU that also runs laps around the HD530. However, these embedded chips come with some significant sacrifices. The N100 only supports one channel of RAM, and most N100 boards come with one RAM slot. It also only comes with 9 PCIe lanes, which means that on most motherboards, you will have one M.2 X2 slot and maybe a PCIe X2 slot if you're lucky. The i3-6100 on the other hand offers 16 lanes, and this motherboard definitely makes good use of them. 8 SATA ports, all of which are connected to the Intel SATA controller, without using any kind of SATA port expanders or external controllers. A full PCIe X16 slot with support for PCIe bifurcation, letting you split it into multiple slots, and 2 gigabit NICs. Now, personally, I think that for home server use, at least for me, the PCIe and SATA connectivity is much more important than full load power efficiency. So, even though the embedded CPU designs draw less power than desktop chips, this comes at a price. And if you're okay with paying this price, something like an ASRock N100DC ITX could be the right choice for you. Myths number 7 and 8, PSU myths. Now, I couldn't find a good name for this particular one, so I'm just going to use this category to consolidate a few common misconceptions about power supplies. The first one is, the higher the PSU rating, the lower its idle power consumption. By rating, I mean things like 80 bronze, 80 gold, 80 platinum, etc. The thing is, the 80 plus ratings only show us the PSU efficiency at 20, 50, and 100% load. So, for instance, in order to qualify for 80 bronze, a PSU has to achieve 82% at 20% load, 85% at 50% load, and 82% efficiency at 100% load. And if we look at the titanium level, it also adds a 10% load measurement. A titanium PSU has to achieve 90% efficiency at 10% load, 92% efficiency at 20% load, 94% at 50% load, and finally, 90% efficiency at 100% load. However, most power efficient home server builds will draw less than 30 watts at idle, which, if we take a bog standard consumer power supply at around 750 watts, is less than 3%. Unfortunately, most ATX power supplies are very inefficient at lower loads, and this inefficiency doesn't always get better with higher rated PSUs. Take this Corsair CX450M for example. This PSU is rated 80 bronze, and at 20 watts, it reaches 71% efficiency. Now let's look at the gold rated Seasonic Focus Plus 550 watts. At 20 watts, it actually only reaches 70% efficiency. At the same time, Corsair RM550X, another gold rated power supply, reaches as much as 80% at 20 watt power draw. That's a 10% difference between two power supplies with the same 80 plus rating. Now, obviously, there is usually some sort of correlation between the PSU rating and its efficiency, even at lower loads. But these figures usually aren't as strictly controlled and don't have any influence on the 80 plus rating. So, choose your power supply carefully, don't trust the 80 plus ratings, and always look at the lower load testing if that's available. Finally, the last myth that I want to talk about today is lower wattage PSUs are more efficient at lower loads. The best example for that is Corsair's SF PSUs, the SF450 and the SF600. If we look at the 20 watt tests, we'll actually see that SF600 is more efficient than the lower wattage SF450. Not by a huge margin, but still. And when it comes to very low wattage ATX PSUs, like 250 watts or 300 watts, these are usually based on pretty old technology. As desktop components got more and more power hungry, the manufacturers shifted to 600, 800, and now 1000 watt PSUs as the mainstream. And I think that that's one of the reasons why Corsair discontinued the RM550X. 550 watts is simply not enough for a modern gaming system. Now, don't get me wrong, there is definitely some correlation between the PSU's wattage and its efficiency at lower loads. But just like with the 80 plus rating, I wouldn't recommend just blindly going for the low watt option without doing any research. Always look at the reviews and pay attention to lower load testing. So there you have it guys, we busted 8 common power efficiency myths. And I hope that this information will help you build a powerful and power efficient home server for all of your home servering needs. As usual, I would like to thank my patrons. James Eppington, Kevin Ware, Alessandro Calori, Carlos Benilla, David Love, Jubastica, Matthew K, Robots Dream of Crypto, and everyone else supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.